Lord, I just thank you for the opportunity for us, the body, to get together tonight. And hopefully we can learn something from what you put on my heart. And Lord, I pray that I be able to read all this correctly and speak correctly and remember everything. Lord, you're worthy of worship. I thank you for the worship we had tonight. It was just an awesome time. So Lord, I ask you to bless this evening. In Jesus' name, amen. I'm going to start out by giving you guys a little bit of my testimony of my life before I became a Christian, and share with you, because a lot of you guys don't know me and don't know my life story or anything like that. So from birth, 1959, till summer of 1972, I was religious, yet impatient, jealous, unkind, self-centered, arrogant, rude, angry, calloused, unloving, and seek my own way. I was easily provoked and proud. That's who I am without the Lord in my life. Nothing to offer outside of sin. My mom had several health problems during her pregnancy, and I was born underweight and premature. By third grade, I was officially diagnosed as having dyslexia compounded by attention deficit disorder and hyperactivity. So if you had a tough kid before, I was that kid. And I was telling someone here recently, they were talking about some kids running around the church as well. When I was a little kid, I was actually found at the very top of the steeple of the church. And the kid that I was with was a paraplegic, and we strapped him on my back, and we climbed up there. So that's what Kurt was like back then. I was a terror. Looking back on it now, my mom was the greatest advocate a learning disabled child could ever want. Got through this no problem at home. School is exceptionally cruel for the learning disabled. Especially when they're mainstreamed back into the public school system. Being teased and being called a retard would have completely crushed me if I didn't have a loving mom to come home to.
You need
me. Yeah. The sound system's over there. Maybe we can have someone turn it up.
I'll have you turn it up. I have no clue.
Maybe I just need to speak without tearing up here. There we go.
Okay.
If I'm feeding back, let me know. Sounds pretty loud now. After failing third grade, my mom got me into a pilot program at the University of Oregon for dyslexic children. I went into a program unable to read, write, or sit still. I came out able to read and write, but sit still, not so much. The remainder of grade school and junior high included special ed classes, tutors, and summer school. I wanted to play with all the other kids at school after school, but Mom, knowing what's best for me, hired tutors from the university to help prepare me for the real world. Part of this is hard because I lost my mom recently. And she was a real dear friend of mine, I tell you. After third grade, my folks got tired of me coming home by police car. I kept getting caught climbing through construction sites in the neighborhood. Mom and Dad talked with special ed experts and doctors for advice. Yeah, I was found literally up in the rafters of some new houses that are being built. And one day I actually took my bicycle and I hoisted it up to the third floor of a mansion there that had a big opening in the floor for the fireplace to go through. I put a ramp on this side because there's lots of plywood laying around. I jumped over that gap. You know, that's what the kind of kid I was. So mom and dad were given two options, Redlin or move out to the country and keep me so busy in sports and activities that I'd be too tired to get into too much trouble. So they did. And they sold our house and our family moved to a small farm 6 miles outside the city limits of Eugene. And it was a wonderful time. We had horses and cows and all the good stuff that a kid can enjoy, and I could be as crazy as I want and it didn't matter. Dad's new assignment was spending time with me in the Pee Wee wrestling program, which included tournaments all over the Northwest. Mom's job was to getting me to the YMCA and judo and to give my hyperactivity a less destructive outlet. So you kind of get a picture of what it took for my folks to try to raise this kid. It was not easy. It gets worse. The summer of 1972 marks the time my mom tried punishing me after mouthing off to her. I snatched the belt out of her hands. I shoved her down and callously I slammed the door behind my back. That's what I was like. Through her tears, my mom informed me that she was done disciplining me and that it was the Lord's turn. That was fine by me. Full of myself at 13, I dug in my heels and took on the big guy in the sky. Believe me, he was up to the challenge. A few days later, I went to junior high church camp. I did my best into my feelings and emotions as I sat through the most detailed and gruesome teaching on the crucifixion of Christ. In fact, I've never heard it in such detail, still to this day. You know, the Passion of the Christ, that, you know, that movie, couldn't hold a candle what this guy did. He had that flagellum in there. He had the crown. For a kid my age, it was worse than any horror R-rated movie you could ever watch. It was horrible. But yet, my heart of stone still managed to resist giving in to multiple altar calls full of what I considered weak and emotional teenagers. And I didn't give in. Well, the first night home from camp was miserable. I was visited by the Holy Spirit, and in my struggle with Him, my sheets and I were totally drenched in sweat. Completely exhausted, bound in soaked sheets, the Holy Spirit won my undivided attention, which is, as you can see, that would not be easy to get. He informed me that short of complete surrender to the Lord and Him completely transforming my life, I would be hopelessly incapable of loving anyone but myself or receiving love forever. He pointed out that no one on earth loved me as much as my parents, and that my heart of stone was unable to even show love to them, let alone a wife someday. That shook me. I had a friend who, the kid that I carried up the top of the steeple, his mom and dad went through a divorce. He was on the church board and everything. Nobody knew anything was going on, but one day he was with his wife, the next day he was with a secretary. And it shook me up, because this best buddy of mine, he and I were, as either at his house or my house. It wasn't what we're doing this weekend. It was, you know, we're always together. And that was hard for me to see, his dad just leave a whole family over selfishness. I was told that without surrender to the Lord, I was told that without surrender to the Lord, not only my life, but anyone associated with it would be put through a living hell on earth, and then, for me, an eternity of torment. It almost reminds me of the Christmas story, you know, being visited by the Holy Spirit and him just being real blatantly honest with me. It was hard. I realized my only hope was to surrender to my Savior, the one who proved he loved me by laying down his life for me. The one who willingly endured such a gruesome punishment for my sins. The one who shed his blood so I could be forgiven and spend eternity with him. The Holy Spirit informed me that the Lord would create a whole new heart for me, because my old heart of stone was damaged far beyond repair. My new heart would be tender and the polar opposite of my old heart of stone. That's why I can't just keep a stiff upper lip. I'm just having a hard time. The Lord changed my heart so much that it's hard for me to talk in public. I hate it, actually. But I think you guys need to hear my story. So, Psalms 51:10. I'm reading out of the Amplified Bible because it's a little bit more explanatory, and I don't have to do like Glenn does and do all the background stuff. But Psalms 51:10 says, "Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right and steadfast spirit within me." And that's what the Lord did. He gave me a new heart. He didn't fix the old one. He just gave me a brand new one. Finally, like those kids at camp, I too, weak and emotional, not only surrendered to the big guy in the sky, but Jesus Christ became my Savior, my friend, Lord, and Master. What I've learned through the process of my heart of stone being replaced with a tender heart is that in Christ, I'm capable of truly loving others even more than myself. You know, we talk about we're free. For me, that's huge freedom. To finally be free to love others. And I wasn't before. I was completely incapable of that. Galatians 5:19-26 kind of talks about the transition of a heart going from the heart of stone. And then I'm going to end up in 1 Corinthians chapter 13. Again, this is Amplified Bible, so it's going to be hard for you to read along. But Galatians 5:19-26. Now the practices of the sinful nature are clearly evident. There are sexual immorality, impurity, sensuality, total irresponsibility, lack of self-control, idolatry, sorcery, hostility, strife, jealousy, fits of anger, disputes, dissensions, factions that promote heresies, envy, drunkenness, righteousness behavior, and other things like these. I warn you beforehand, just as I did previously, that those who practice such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. There is something I want to say about that. You may find yourself, in fact, Leanne and I just yesterday, I started, why am I even up here? I find myself totally disqualified to talk to you guys about love because I blew it. And I had to tell Leanne I'm sorry and ask her to forgive me. But I don't practice to perfect how to be mean to Leanne. You know, there's what they're talking about here is if you practice these things, then you're not going to inherit the kingdom of God, because you're only fooling yourself if you're practicing these things and think you're a Christian. I'm sorry, but you're fooling yourself. If your life is not transformed, you fall into things every once in a while, but you feel guilty and you ask forgiveness. Verse 22, but the fruit of the Spirit, the result of his presence within us, is love, unselfish concern for others, joy, inner peace, patience, not the ability to wait, but how we act while waiting, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such things there is no law. And those who belong to Jesus Christ have crucified the sinful nature together with his passions and appetites. If we claim to live by the Holy Spirit, we must also walk by the Spirit with personal integrity, godly character, and moral courage, our conduct empowered by the Holy Spirit. We must not become conceited, challenging or provoking one another, envying one another. So it kind of tells you what to put off and what to put on. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, again out of the Amplified Bible. If I speak with the tongues of men and of angels, but have not love for others, grown out of God's love for me, then I have become only a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal, just an annoying distraction. And if I have a gift of prophecy and speak a new message from God to the people and understand all mysteries and possess all knowledge, and if I have all sufficient faith so that I can move mountains but do not have love reaching out to others, I am nothing. If I give all my possessions to feed the poor, and if I surrender my body to be burned but do not have love, it does me no good at all. Verse 4, love endures with patience and serenity. Love is kind and thoughtful and is not jealous or envious. Love does not brag, it is not proud or arrogant. It is not rude, it is not self-seeking. It is not provoked, nor overly sensitive, which I was yesterday, and easily angered. It does not take into account a wrong endured. It does not reject at injustice, but rejoices with the truth when right and truth prevail. Love bears all things, regardless of what comes. That's a tough one. Believes all things, looking for the best in each other, hopes all things, remaining steadfast during difficult times, endures all things without weakening. Love never fails, it never fades nor ends. But for all prophecies, they'll all pass away because we'll know everything already. As far as tongues, they will cease. For the gift of special knowledge, it will pass away. For we know in part and prophesy in part, but our knowledge is fragmented and incomplete. But when that which is complete and perfect comes, that which is incomplete, partial, will pass away. When I was a child, I talked like a child. When I was a child, I reasoned like a child. When I became a man, I did away with childish things. For now, in this time of imperfection, we see in a mirror dimly, a blurred reflection, a riddle, an enigma. But then, when the time of perfection comes, we will see reality face to face. Now I know in part, just in fragments, but then I will know fully, just as I have been known fully by God. And now there remains faith, abiding in truth in God and His promises, hope, confident expression, our expectation of eternal salvation, love, unselfish love for others growing out of God's love for me. These three, the choicest of graces, but the greatest of these is love. Excuse me. So over the years, Leanne and I have done everything from premarital counseling for people to triage counseling for marriages that seem broken beyond help. That's just something the Lord has had us do a lot, especially as we had home fellowships for many, many years. We ended up doing a lot of counseling. And believe it or not, we had told these couples that it's perfectly okay to look for faults and failures in your spouse. At first, they look shocked. Now, let me explain. Don't get upset here. We explained to them that it's when they have been wounded by their spouse's faults and failures that they can clearly show and prove their love for them. Love is an action, not a feeling. My mom and dad showed and proved their love for me because I gave them countless opportunities. My mom had her very first car ever that was not a hand-me-down. She bought a brand new Buick Skylark. It's kind of like the Buick, or like the Chevy Chevelle back in the day. And Mom loved that car. It was a hot rod. It had a V8 engine. Well, I turned 16, and that parked car was put through the paces with me, and up on a corner, I went around too fast, I had a blowout, and had a head-on collision with another guy, and totaled both cars, injured the other guy, I called my mom, and just to show you how her love for me was totally, just amazing. I called her and I said, "Mom, I just wrecked your car." She didn't say one word about that car for days. She just says, "Are you okay?" I said, "Believe me, there's more to this story. I won't go into a lot of detail, but it was miraculous. I was completely uninjured, and it was definitely a miracle. I can talk to you guys about some other time in private, but it had to do with angels and everything else. But I told her I'm fine, and she showed up, gave me a big hug. She chewed me out. For 3 days later, you know, she says she missed her car, but I don't remember ever getting chewed out for that stupid thing I did. She's loved me that much. And so anyways, if love is long-suffering or patient, how can that type of love be demonstrated in a relationship without failing? How do you be patient if there's no reason for it? How do you even demonstrate that type of love if your spouse is perfect? They never test your patience. You know, kind of like a Stepford wife or what do you want to call it. You know, love is a response to the flaws in one another, if you think about it. If love is kindness, how can we exhibit kindness in a relationship without flaws? If love is keeping no record of wrong, how can we prove that characteristic of love in a relationship without defects? If love is forgiving those who trespass against us, how can we establish that aspect of love in a relationship without pain? If your spouse is so perfect, you never are wounded by them, how do you forgive them? It'll never happen. You know, there's a song out right now called "Broken Together." It's worth listening to. You know, recently I said I lost my mom. You know, I lost Dad a couple of years ago and lost my mom this year. And we all got together. It was kind of weird. We weren't all, you know, sad and lonely and sad and all that. We were just celebrating the life that we had of two godly parents. And I love to tease my siblings. I told them that Mom and Dad loved me the most because I was the black sheep of the family, giving them countless opportunities to demonstrate their love for me. You know, we all kind of laugh, but it's true. You know, they had the ability to just show their love for me over and over again. And it wasn't the type of parent who just says, "Yeah, no, Johnny, that's okay." Mom did discipline me. Dad disciplined me. They loved me enough to do that, but they always gave me grace and mercy. Look at your kids and your spouse's failures as opportunities to demonstrate and prove your love for them. Until they fail you. You know, I've told people, look for the opportunities when they do fail you. Then seize it and just say, that's the moment where you just take your husband or your wife and embrace them, say, "Honey, it's okay. It's all right. Well, none of us are perfect." Romans 5:8 out of the Amplified Bible. But God clearly showed and proved his own love for us by the fact that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. While we were the ones putting him up on the cross, we were the ones that actually created the sin that made him endure our punishment. Even then, he loved us. I mean, we might as well have been whipping him, being the one doing it. We might as well be the one that hung on the cross because it was our sins that did it. We hurt him, you know, and he still loved us. How much more are we supposed to love our spouses and our children when they wound us? Yeah. Ephesians 5:28, again, of the Amplified Bible says, "Husbands, love your wives. Seek the highest good for her and surround her with a caring, unselfish love, just as Christ also loved the church and gave himself up for her." So it's pretty clear. We need to be able to bear the wounds of one another and love one another and forgive one another, give grace to each other. And I know, like Leah, and she's the most loving woman in this whole room because she's had more opportunities to demonstrate it. I'm not easy to live with, and but she has been just a blessing for me, and I would not be the man I am today if God had not given me this gift sitting in the front row there. So let's go ahead and, I don't know if you guys have any questions or anything, but we have plenty of time to pray and all that kind of thing. Anybody have any questions that they wanted to ask? Mm-hmm. Well, reading out loud is the scariest thing this guy has ever done in his life. Well, asking me to stand up and read is just impossible.
Well, the thing about it is that I'm sure when you made your notes and practiced it, it just came through just nice and smooth. You were like,
yeah.
Obama.
Yeah. Yeah.
You came out like a disciple of God.
Yeah. That's true. I was saved at 13, yeah, and oddly enough, I knew the word really well. I grew up in a church, I grew up in a Christian home, but for me, it was I was fooling myself, and I asked the Holy Spirit to come into my life because it required Him to change me. And without that power, it just would not have happened, period. That would have been a mess. You else have any questions?
Yeah.
Nate came home last night. I picked him up at 3:30 at the airport. And praise the Lord, this is the first time I've seen him after a big, long trip where he felt rested and alert. He wasn't sick. Normally he picks up something there that just makes him sicker than a dog, and he said he didn't have one issue, period. And he was really blessed. And Joseph is I don't want to steal Nate's thunder. I'll let Nate explain to it. He's actually going to share with us what happened during this trip. But Joseph is a man who. He's just doing miracle after miracle. He's actually leading imams to the Lord. This guy is. And pretty proud of Nate. Nate took the time to go over there and basically do a mini seminar, or not a seminar, but a mini... he took a week or 10 days with a whole bunch of people there and taught them, like seminary, I guess you'd say. Taught them how to rightly divide the word and how to, they didn't even know the difference between the New and the Old Testament. These guys were actually sharing the Lord and saving people left and right, but they didn't know anything about the Bible. And Nate, being a Bible teacher, went over there to help them learn how to do that. And the next trip we take over there, Nate invited me to go with them, and I'd like to go. They have at least 10 people who would like to attend that class again. And so... I'm sure we'll make that invitation to you guys. It's not a not a vacation type thing. It's tough. It's over 100 degrees. You're in India, of all places. You have to be physically fit, so I have to lose weight just to go with them if I can. Because if you have, you may have to be physically fit for a reason I don't want to go into a lot of detail. But being able to go over there and teach the indigenous people how to... share the gospel is so much more effective than sending white gringo over there to try to share the Lord. And it's interesting how inexpensive it is to support someone that effective when they live there and grew up there versus us send over a person and set them up in a nice palatial house. So anyways, any other questions? Okay. Well, on Wednesdays, do we normally have praise reports too? Yes, we should, huh? Anybody have any praise reports for this week before we pray? Yeah.
I took one of my friends out for dinner last night. I would call him a Christian.
write that.
Well, I already shared my praise report about Nate coming home. I love being able to be a part of his life, and I love just being in the car alone with him and hearing him tell these stories. It's pretty cool. Well, as far as prayers go, we can pray for Glenn. He's in the middle of trying to move and all those sort of things, and pray for those who are going to try to fill his shoes while he's here. Hopefully they can speak better than I do. I'm sure they can. But let's open a prayer. And then as Lord lays something on your heart, go ahead and pray. And then if you feel led to come alongside that same prayer and keep it going, you're welcome to do that. It's just conversational prayer. Lord, I thank you for the opportunity for us to get together tonight. And thank you for helping me through. As you know, Lord, this is scary for me to speak in front of people, especially when I have to read. And so, Lord, I pray that they heard what you had for them to hear. And the things that weren't important, I pray they just forget it all. Lord, I pray you bless Glenn and Yvonne as they're moving this next week and a half, and help them to be able to accomplish that without getting injuries to their backs. Or I pray that the cars hold up and all their furniture doesn't get broken.